just real quick, I want to apologize in advance. This review that you're about to watch was kind of a rush job. I don't like that. Yeah, I'm glad that we got three episodes, but with my busy schedule, I kind of had to jam a lot into this review in a fast amount of time. The next reviews, the single episode reviews, will be much more tight, and I will have notes. This one I didn't have notes for, so everything was pretty improvised, and I just donated plasma. You can see the little mark there. So I'm a little... So hopefully next time it won't be like that. So enjoy the review, hopefully. All right. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the channel. This is Rob here at Smirking Gun Reviews, and we're back to talk more stuff. And this time we're talking about The Boys Season 2. They also dropped three episodes. So yesterday, Raised by Wolves drops their first three episodes. And then the long anticipated Season 2 of The Boys dropped actually kind of early last night. Unfortunately, I had to be up at 5 o'clock in the morning to donate plasma. And so I could only start watching it last night. I had to go to bed. And I didn't finish watching everything until now. And, oh my goodness, I got to press pause because my controller's acting weird. It's like messed up when you start seeing everything go down on you. So, yeah, I just finished watching episode 3. It is 8:34 in the morning. I'm sure that all the people who get early access have already been pumping out their reviews. And this will be... have some spoilers. We are going to be talking a little bit about each episode, but first and foremost, I want to bring up the reason if I don't talk about everything, especially because it's three episodes, but also because over on the channel D's Reviews with Darren Jakes, if you are not familiar with his channel, he does a lot of stuff as well, covers stuff like I do, does like Walking Dead, things like that, but we've been also doing Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. together as fans of S.H.I.E.L.D., but now that Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is over, We're going to be doing some more of that, but every Tuesday night, I believe it's 8 o'clock Central, 9 o'clock Eastern, 6 o'clock Pacific, we'll be doing Fans of the Boys, where we'll go in depth on all the episodes. The other reason I don't want to make this a real long video is because it's three episodes, and this could be at least an hour long of a video just talking about these three episodes. But first impressions are, we're right back in our going full steam ahead. Now, my initial reaction to this show was kind of negative because it just felt like, it just kind of felt a little hopeless. And just watching villains, it made me think about Injustice, the really popular Superman Goes Bad comic. Turn viewing about a month ago, I watched all eight episodes again, and I kind of had a change of heart, and I definitely like it a lot more now than I did then. I liked it. I love Carl Urban. I had problems with the Huey character because he's like the conscience of the group. But one of the other problems I had was because of the book. Now, if you think the show is hardcore, that is nothing compared to the book. The book is unapologetically in your, like, it's nuts. It's hardcore. And if you thought that it was hardcore in season one, that's just nothing compared to the book. Somehow they found a way to sanitize this book a little bit for the show. Like, example, I'll tell you this. If you're familiar with season one, if you're watching season two before season one, what's wrong with you? But, like, in season one, when Starlight is... told by the Deep that if she wants to be a part of the Seven, she needs to go down on him. In the book, it's not just that. They run a train on her. And the Deep isn't even a part of it. But it's like... And it's Homelander that does it, and they all go to town on her. And it's like, holy shit. So they take the elements of the book and then they find a way to kind of tone it down a little bit because the book's tone is very dark and very, very, very mature. That being said, also, the story compared to the comic book, they really just go right to it in the show. They go right after Homelander. In the book, it's long form, so they're taking their time. They go after smaller groups of heroes, younger heroes at the beginning. You don't even really see Homelander for a while. You don't even see a lot of this stuff for a while. Is getting right to it. And I think it's mainly because how long can you really make a show like this go on before it gets like stale? And also because the main character, like the main villain, Homelander, is a Superman type, you can only hold off a character like that believably from your heroes. And since they're all regular people aside from Kimiko, it's hard to suspend your disbelief. And sometimes it's still hard to suspend my disbelief a little bit about the Homelander character and why he doesn't just run everything. They make him a little more psychologically complex and give him kind of messed up psychological reasons to why he doesn't do exactly what he wants 100% of the time and go full on bad Superman. And I think that that's one of the only things, like, they had to figure out a way to do that. There's also a lot of correlations with this character that's very hard to watch, especially now. Like last year, just how bad he was, it was kind of like, again, like watching Superman go bad. And I think a lot of other, some people are kind of tired of that. But since he's not Superman, you get a little more leeway. And they give him like this like crazy dark past of him being conflicted about how he came to be in the first place. They gave him a kid. He's always just looking for a family. He was made this way, but then he's also kind of always been this way and just got worse. And after a while, there's you don't sympathize with this character at all. And in fact, it's very hard to sympathize at all with any of the heroes on this show. Like the Deep in this first part of the season, he's trying to figure out what went wrong. Why is my life this bad? And it's like because you're a sexual predator and you let your insecurities, you take it out on women. And now you are where you are, and he's still feeling sorry for himself. And it's kind of funny almost, if it wasn't kind of pathetic, watching him try to get better. Where it's like, yes, people can be redeemed, but in this show, the only redemption I want from any of these heroes is to self-sacrifice. There is no, like, even if the Deep realizes all the bad things he's done to women, because even at this point he's still kind of like, duh. There is no real, like, we can realize that you understand what you've done wrong, but I don't know if necessarily forgiveness is anything I'm interested in. Also with the characters like A-Train, who, got this power, then got addicted to mainlining the super stuff, to getting supercharged, and then killed Huey's, girlfriend on accident. But it wouldn't have happened in the first place if he wasn't abusing the power. And he was abusing the power before he was abusing drugs. And it doesn't change here. Even after the heart attack from season one, he's still the same old guy. He's just not addicted to the V anymore. And who knows if he'll, and he could backslide into that real quick because he's weakened after the heart attack. He might be looking to recharge with V again. That might kill him straight outright, though. But he hasn't changed the asshole that he is in the inside. The guy who's just chasing fame and all the things that go with it, and realizing that his power can basically let him do anything. And then you got Maeve, who, has been compromised for a really long time, who was like Starlight, that wanted to do good, but because of the corrupting influence and of Homelander, but also not just his corrupting influence, but the fear of Homelander has let her just do all sorts of things because she protecting herself rather than the world. She could have just let him, like, if she says no, he kills her, right? Well, nobody will stand up to him because nobody knows how to. And so that's another thing, is the fear of this kind of almost omnipotent character one of the reasons I was talking about earlier why it's hard to watch it is because of the state of this country right now. And I don't want to get on my soapbox again like I did on my truth about Trump and racism video. But it is kind of hard to watch this show for myself, watching another just absolute, like, if Trump watched this show and watched Homelander, he would be thinking Homelander's the hero of the show and that everyone else is the villain. Because that's how Homelander sees himself. He doesn't see himself as a villain. Really good villains in entertainment are like that, but it's also true in real life. Most villains think that they're justified in what they do. And so it's a little hard watching a guy who, just feels like the rest of the world is against him when it's like, no, motherfucker, you're a murderer and a psychopath, a sociopath of the highest degree. Maybe you were made this way, but at some point, he knows that there are choices that you make, and you got to own up to him, and he's so deluded that he can't. And it's the with this character for me comes a lot of hopelessness of how do you resolve this? There's no real clean way to stop Superman. Every time they try to do something to him, it only, it's about holding him back more than stopping him. But at the beginning of this, and I know I've talked a lot, right, already about all the other stuff, the things that are ancillary, but the beginning where we left off last season is was taken by Homelander out of Elizabeth Shue's house after he burned her face, burned right through her face, blows up her house. You didn't know what happened to the baby. The baby, it turns out, just was over like 17 miles away or something like that. And he leaves Butcher after taking him to see his wife and her kid, which is his Homelander's kid. Butcher wakes up in a parking lot of a Tony Cicero's, which I don't even know what that is, but I do know if that's even a real place. And he just goes right on about his business. Basically, he doesn't even kill Butcher because he doesn't consider him even that kind of a threat. And he enjoys having that information that not only did I screw your wife and got her pregnant, I've been hiding her this whole time. I have a kid with her. That's the level of psychosis this man has, this level of evil that he could just kill Butcher. And he wants him to know that I could kill you at any moment, but I like seeing you suffer. Now you got the rest of the team, Huey, who's working secretly with Starlight to try to get some compound V to expose Vought. But the thing is, and I was thinking this the entire time, is that one of the big parts of this show is showing the danger of corporations, the danger of celebrity worship, the danger, like, just how the media spins things, and showing kind of an even bigger light on that too, that, like, showing how the media covers things. And when you correlate that to how things are today, it really turns your stomach. No matter what side you're on politically, both sides do it like in some pretty horrifying ways. And that is just really kind of one of the things at the forefront of this season. And especially the corporation part. So, like, even though I knew that if from the trailer that they were going to have the Compound B be found out, all you have to have is a Giancarlo Esposito, who is great, by the way. There's a scene in here where he stands down Homelander, and I was like, there's Gus Fring. There he is. Only that guy in that situation could make a Superman-type character shut down for a minute and realize, I got you over a barrel. Even though I still say, if Homelander wants, he can just take whatever he wants. It just makes for a less interesting story. The show would be over in a second. Homelander kills everyone. The end. Why doesn't anybody love me? Burn, like, he'd just burn the whole world. And then fly off, who knows, into space and find other places that'll worship him. I don't know. But Giancarlo Esposito, who, once confronted with this, All it's just a matter of trying to figure out when they can spin it to fit their needs and how quickly the media eats it up and how quickly they expect us to just eat it up. And the problem is that in like in real life, people eat this shit up. They eat the lies. So it's like you've got the corporations lying to you, you got the how the media covers it to you, and then you just spoon it up and say, okay, or we're just forced to sit there and swallow it while people just lie to our faces every single second of every single day just to keep us where they want us. There's a whole lot of that in this show. And that might, for people that can see past just the hero, the regular people versus the hero storyline, that some people will just only see that. They will only see that. But for those of you that can like see through all of it, it's a lot. It really is a lot. So they package it up. It's kind of like South Park, right? You could just say that South Park is just a story about some foul-mouthed little kids, and that's it. Instead, if you look past all that, if you look past the vulgarity, if you look at past the ridiculousness of the stories, there's always something in there that's deeper. This thing's got a lot of depth to it. And it's just really difficult. It's really difficult right now. And it's, as entertaining as it is, like Lovecraft Country, it hits you with a lot of socio-political issues. And again, I'm kind of frazzled, and it's taken a lot of this has been really hard for me to just keep watching and watching stuff like this. It just makes me feel worse about the world I'm living in. So it takes a little bit away from my entertainment and enjoyment of it. Thankfully, they have moments where a guy drives a speedboat into the side of a whale, which is horrifying, but at the same time, kind of comical. But we'll get to that. So Huey and Starlight eventually find a guy that can get him the V. That's another pretty awful thing. The guy can grow his limbs back, and he pays people in hotels to cut off his body parts for money. She films it, she blackmails him, and he gets her the V because he works in the labs at Vought. We've also got Kimiko trying to communicate that there's this super terrorist that was brought in by Vought, and it turns out to be her brother. It's something that I don't know why I didn't catch on immediately. I thought that maybe the brother option would be too obvious, but once you find the tattoo on the guy's chest that she rips his head off, then immediately that it's her brother. And I was excited because, when you find out he's got powers too and he's really powerful, that there would be an extra addition to their team that could help them fight. Give them at least a little bit more of an advantage, not an advantage, but a bump in their abilities to try to stop characters like Homelander. But unfortunately, there's also another addition to the show this season, and that's Aya Cash's Stormfront. Aya Cash is an interesting actress. I like her. She was on that show, You're the Worst. And she's really interesting because she starts off one way, and then quickly, by the end of the third episode, you realize that she's not anything like you think she is. And she's playing a pretty deep game herself. She comes off as, I'm the girl who's going to tell you how it is. Kind of like how I try to keep it real here. But what if I actually was just wanting to take control and power over, everything? Maybe I am. No, but she comes off at first to Starlight as, I'm going to tell it straight. I'm going to say, fuck you, Watt, and be real about things. And calling out, she calls out Starlight, makes her Starlight feel bad about wearing the costume that she's wearing, and that she's not going to play the game. And immediately I went, why would Vought let somebody like her, I'm going to move this a second so here's the light comes back. Why would Vought let somebody like her be the next, whoa, member of the Seven? It becomes plainly clear later on why. She's a liar. She's just a straight up liar. She's very powerful. I don't know if you can call her, they call her Stormfront. I haven't seen her control the weather. I've just seen her be really strong, and she can shoot electricity from her hands. But clearly, yeah, like she's got strength, but you don't find that out right away. And so she even like is the sassy one that comes in. But finally, right, all of a sudden there's a couple of clues later on where she starts to kind of her authenticity starts to slip. And when she's actually given a chance to be a hero and she's like, I'm here to stop the bad guys, she just turns into another Homelander. And her turn is pretty quick, and you can even see on Homelander's face that he's kind of scared, not scared, irritated, that she's going to be vying for the top spot at their, out of the seven. Now, again, why doesn't he just wait for her to like get away from a camera and zap her face off and just say, I don't know what happened? Because honestly, those are the things that I keep thinking about all the time while I watch this show is he kills with impunity. And the way Vought covers things up, like about everything, about every civilian death, about how the heroes even die, like they cover up Translucent's way of death because they can't let anybody know, of course, that there are people trying to stop them. And it's just lie after lie after lie. And I think that's another, like I said, going back to why and how I watch it, it's everyone is just, they're all such liars. Even the good guys. The good guys don't tell each other the full truths all the time. And so when everybody's like a liar character, just about, when everybody is constantly holding things back for the sake of the story, it kind of gets a little rough for me. Now, we've got other things like there are some highlights. I mean, the Deep getting involved with this church to find his way back to being a hero. And he takes some mushrooms and he hears Patton Oswalt as his gills talking to him. It's so weird. But the thing is again, because you don't care about what, like this character is a bad guy. I don't really care if he gets better. They're all so delusional that I have a hard time with that as well. But like I said, they finally get. They capture Kimiko's brother, the boys do. They're trying to keep him from joining up with the terrorist group that she was a part of. They're trying to deliver him to the CIA so that they can have their records cleaned and they can start trying to find Becca, Butcher's wife. Even then, I feel like that's such a pipe dream trying to get her out of the place that she's at, especially when Homelander knew every single word she was saying. He's got super hearing. Especially like, if you want to talk about that, like when Maeve was talking to Elena, boom, he already knows about her. He already knows about her. And it's like, well, it's just a matter of time before she dies. Speaking of dies, Jennifer Esposito's death. Well, I guess she's not going to be on the show anymore. Kaboom. But in the they get away, they're on a boat, they take the guy away, and we're in the third episode. And I know we haven't really talked too many details about the show really, but they're in a boat trying to get to the CIA when the boat was reported stolen, a helicopter shows up, Kimiko's brother gets loose, and I mean this was kind of like the highlight of all three episodes. That's why I'm kind of highlighting it. Is he destroys the police boat helicopter and they are trying to get back to shore. Meanwhile, the Deep got information saying this is your chance to be a hero, this is your chance to return to the Seven. And so he goes there with a bunch of sharks or dolphins or whatever to try to stop them from getting away. And he uses a great to get in their way as well. And he's, it's just such a good, glorious superhero moment if he wasn't a fucking piece of shit. And he's standing there like, what are you gonna do? And it's like, this is what the show just delights in itself, where Billy Butcher, played by Carl Urban, again, so fantastic, smashes right into the whale, knocking Deep out, and they all have to escape through the storm drains. Well, the Seven arrive, and the Deep's basically told, hey, great job, but you're still not coming back. you're still a pervert. Although Homelander just probably wouldn't let him back in because he made that comment about his gills. And I still feel like they're heading towards the deep, doing some sort of, not really redemption, but more like he's going to try to fuck over Homelander in the end. I think that there'll be some sort of ace in the hole for that. Like, he'll have some kind of hero moment before Homelander probably just rips him in half. So they go after the boys in the storm drains. And I was thinking, well, they've got A-Train, so why can't he just run through there? But they have the whole heart attack thing, so he can't run as fast. And so they explain away why he couldn't just go, oh, found him in like 2 seconds. The other thing was, well, he can fly. And probably run really fast too. So why, and couldn't he also, doesn't he have like X-ray vision? I can't remember. But, you know, like, why don't they just explain that away? But whatever. But eventually Starlight finds Huey, knocks him out, and Homelander puts it to her that if you don't kill him, I'm going to kill you. Which is when Butcher comes out and says, you know, hey, see you next Tuesday. Suck on this. Kimiko's brother drops a whole bunch of cars and concrete on top of him to help them escape. But then that's when Kimiko's brother, he takes off. Kimiko goes after him. And this is when we see the villain turn of Stormfront, who is not a hero, who is not trying to do her job. She wants to do her job, but anyone gets in her way, and not. She kills the whole family that saw her. She threw a guy through their house, but she just straight up kills him without even a second thought. So she's just as bad as Homelander. And then she rips Kimiko's brother's hands off and chokes him out until he dies. And Homelander shows up and he's just pissed that he didn't get to kill him. And she takes the spotlight from him at the news conference, which you can see visibly. Is there something up with Homelander, Anthony Starr's jaw? The way he plays him, there's just like this way that his jaw looks that makes me think of Marlon Brando in The Godfather. There just seems to be something happening in the cheeks area. Am I crazy, or does it always look like there's something going on here in the jaw area? But my last other thing is about Huey. Yeah, okay, in the book, he's got a bit of a conscience. He's also based on Simon Pegg. And so, for the most part in the book, yeah, he's got a conscience. He is like, what do I do? Why, I'm not anything like you guys. But this is a more sanitized, and he's like the Jiminy Cricket of the show. And several times during this season, I always feel like they've got him written to always hold them back just enough for bad things to happen. Like, I'm, you know, and I know for everybody out there that loves him, right? He's not a bad, it's not the acting and it's not the actor. It's the way that they present him to always be, oh, I can't, oh, we shouldn't, so that it slows down the story so that they can get closer to being caught. And it happens in this. And honestly, when I knew Starlight wasn't going to kill him, but part of me was kind of just wanting his character to be gone. Because he just slows everything down. Now, Mother's Milk does present the idea that if you kill the canary, how do you know when you've gone too far? And they're not wrong. It's just very frustrating. It's like anybody that ever gotten Walter White's way on Breaking Bad. I always was annoyed by anybody who got in his way, because I just wanted to see where that character was going to go. I didn't want anybody standing in his way from getting to where he was going to go. Now, I knew it was always going to go badly for Walter White. I just wanted to see how far they could take it. And with the Huey character, I always feel like he's that character who gets in the other character's ways to get what they need to have done, because he's the character that's supposed to be us. And I guess this says more about me, is I'm like, stop getting in the way. Sometimes shit has to go down. And I'm more of like the Billy Butcher type where it's like, yeah, well, I mean, not complete. I'm like a kind of a split. Like I want to be good like Huey, but I also want to crack some skulls like Billy Butcher. And so I don't know. I'm always conflicted between that. And that's great. I do like that you can have the kind of show that makes you have these kind of feelings. Because like I said, it's not the actor's fault. It's just, I don't know. There's in a lot of shows you have this character who's always the one who's like the conscience of the group. And I'm not saying I don't have a conscience. I have an amazing conscience. I have a lot of empathy. In fact, I think that sometimes I have way too much empathy. But I don't know. We'll talk about it on the Fans of S.H.I.E.L.D. Fans of S.H.I.E.L.D. I'm so used to saying it like that. Fans of S.H.I.E.L.D. Fans of the Boys show that we'll be doing on these reviews on Tuesday. So, like, I could keep going and going and going and going. But we got a lot of stuff to talk about over there on that channel. So, if you like this review, please hit the like button, comment, share, subscribe, hit the bell for all notifications. Also, I got to go to work. So, we'll be back next Friday for the single episode reviews, which will be probably about as long as this, just talking singly about the episodes. So, have a great day. We'll see you next week. Don't forget to watch us over on D's Reviews every Tuesday. It'll be at 8 o'clock Central, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. Have a great one. Check you later.